Take out your Bibles, please. Turn to page 1830. Thank you. We welcome home Kayla Shimke. She's returning home from college. But you're going back, right, Kayla? Yeah, good. Okay. Page 1830, you will find Philippians chapter 4. And since our theme is on joy today, we have this reading from Philippians, which is the joy epistle of Paul. By the way, verses 8 and 9 are is the Bible passage for a Big Ten university. Frank Phelan attended that university, and this is not part of their motto, but it's, I don't know what they call it. Anybody know what university? It's in the Big Ten.
Purdue?
No. No, it's in Chicago. Northwestern, yes. So I'm going to read the first paragraph, and you're going to read the motto or whatever it is of Northwestern University. Rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, because the Lord is near. Don't be anxious about anything. In everything, by prayer, petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, it will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Go ahead.
Find in others, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable. If anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned, received or heard from me, or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you.
And now turn to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. I don't know what page. What page is it? 1587. If there's ever a time of the year where we would say it, there's a season of joy, it would be these days, correct? We have our office parties, we buy gifts, we decorate our homes with Christmas decorations. Any of you, how many of you still buy a real tree? Quite a few of you, yes. You have a real tree at home, good for you. And so this is a season of joy. The songs, if you got your Christmas CDs, they're joyful, they're uplifting, and it's a wonderful time of the year. So today we're going to go through the first chapter of Luke, not all of it, and we're going to focus on what I call the forgotten couple of the Christmas story. And that would be Zechariah and Elizabeth. Yes, by the way, our Christmas program next Saturday includes Zechariah and Elizabeth. It's interesting, I don't ever remember any other program doing that. If you look at the first three chapters of Luke's gospel, the life of John and his relative Jesus are intertwined. We are given both birth announcements by the angel Gabriel, and we are given both birth accounts of both of them. And even as you come to chapter 3, the ministry of Jesus really begins with the ministry of John the Baptizer. So we're going to divide this up, and I'm on page 1587. I'm going to start at verse 5, and then you'll read after me, okay? In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah. He belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both were upright in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly. They had no children because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both well along in years. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. When the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled, gripped with fear. The angel said, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth, she will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy, a delight to you. Many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or fermented drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel he will bring back to the Lord, their God. He will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years." Go ahead.
The angel answered, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not be able to speak until the day has happened, because you will not believe my words, which will come true at the proper time. Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah, and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he would not speak to them. They realized he had seen the vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant, and for 5 months remained in seclusion. The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people."
Turn back a page, and we're going to have another reading at the end. So this sermon is about trust. It's about faith in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Zechariah really becomes a negative example of trust in the God of Israel. Okay? And we're going to go through this. Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth were a wonderful, observant Jewish couple, faithful people of God who worshiped the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They were obedient to God's commands. And there's a word there, a Jewish word, blamelessly. Doesn't mean they didn't do anything wrong, but it means that they observed the laws of God and his regulations and his commands. Now, both of them were descendants of the brother of Moses, Aaron, the high priest. Zechariah was one of 8,000 priests of the day who took turns serving at the temple for 2 weeks out of the year. There were 24 divisions of the priesthood. So he was there 2 weeks out of the year, left his home. Elizabeth was also a direct descendant of Aaron. So theirs was a preferred marriage. And yet, there was one problem. They had no children. And so now we come to this section of where Zechariah is now in the temple. And if you look at verses 8 through 17, a lot of ink is spilt on this section, okay? It's all set up as a divine event. I mean, here you have the temple. For heaven's sakes, we're in the temple. And Zechariah is privileged because he was chosen by lots. Now, if you were a good Jewish person, you would know if you were chosen by lots, what does that mean? God picked you out for this time. It probably was the only time in his life that he had this privilege of actually going into, not the Holy of Holies, but going into the holy place just before the curtain into the Holy of Holies, and there was the altar of incense, and it was his high privilege to light the incense of the prayers of God's people going heavenward. And all of a sudden, here in this divine setting, this divine moment, there stands Gabriel. And immediately, Zechariah is afraid. He says, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been answered." Evidently, Zechariah has been praying for a child for years. Okay? And he goes through this and he says, "Your wife will become pregnant. You will give him the name John. And he will be a joy." If you look at verses 14 through 17, you have at least seven descriptions of this John the Baptizer. "He will be a delight for them." I'm sure he was in their old age. "He will never take wine. He'll be filled with the spirit of Elijah," okay, "and the power of Elijah. And he will prepare the people of Israel and bring them back to the Lord for the Lord's appearing." Wonderful experience. So if you go to verse 18, I love verse 18. Instead of Zechariah saying, "Okay, that sounds great," he says, "You gotta be kidding me." And it isn't just doubt, he disbelieves. He says, "How can this be? I'm an old man." And I thought maybe they changed the wording, and my wife, you know, she's old too. "This can't be possible." And so the angel says, "All right, brother, you're not going to speak for at least probably 10 months until that baby is born, because you did not believe the word of the Lord." The veteran of faith falters. One so attuned to God's way, he knew his Bible, he knew God's law, he knew the power of God at work. And when it comes down to it, when the angel comes in answer to his prayer, he doesn't believe. The point of this first part of the sermon is this can happen to any one of us. It can happen to you, it can happen to me. Especially those of us who love the Lord, who have been children of God since childhood. Those of us who know our Bible very well. Those of us who have seen God's power in our lives over and over again, like Zechariah, when something happens, a prayer is answered, or something happens in our life, and we too ask the question, "How can this be? Why has this happened to me?" Or as someone put it, "Is this really the way things should go?" You see, that happens to us. And the good news is you're not saved by your great faith. Neither am I. We're saved by grace. And oftentimes, in spite of our weak faith, God still comes and works in our lives. Zechariah didn't lose his faith in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He just didn't believe that God could do this. This was impossible. And folks, that happens in your life and mine. When something happens, right away, we think about the difficulty of it. How difficult this is that I have to face this trouble in my life or this challenge in my life. And we think right away, this can't be happening to me, instead of realizing what can God bring through this event in my life and our lives. And that is the struggle of doubt in the journey of faith. You've had it, I've had it. We don't believe fully, we don't trust God fully, and doubt hurts us. It makes me and you timid. Well, we don't really trust God. It makes us timid, and it hurts our spiritual life. Because we don't really trust God, we won't put everything into His hands and our lives. And we think the worst in thinking the best. It damages the quality of our faith. And you know, this whole thing with Zechariah, his response of disbelief is contrasted to Elizabeth and Mary. Now let's go to part two. Let's go to Elizabeth. One of the main lessons we learn is that here you have, living in the same house, this old couple. I'd love to know how old they were. They were beyond childbearing years. That I am quite certain. So living in the same house, here you have this stubborn old man who didn't believe, who can't talk. And then you have his dear wife, Elizabeth, who is what? filled with joy that in her old age the Lord has found favor and took away her disgrace. Now imagine those two living together for those 9-10 months. What an amazing thing. Here you have one who disbelieves and can't talk, and one who believes and is just fine. And there's an interesting phrase there. She was in seclusion till her 5th month. I don't know what that was all about. Maybe until it was obvious she was pregnant, she couldn't hide it any longer. But she's filled with joy. Later on, we're going to hear that her relatives were all overjoyed over the birth of this little boy. So here you have one response and an opposite response in the same house. The point is this: God accomplishes his will, whether or not you believe it or not. It's the way it is. And that's especially true with Jesus. God, the gospel for today is God accomplished his will of salvation in the life of this child, Jesus, and through his death and resurrection to pay for the sins of the world. And that's true, and whether you believe it or not. And there are folks in the same house who believe it, accept it, and those who don't believe it. And that's the reality. God's will is done, not because you and I believe it, but in spite of it. And the reality is, in this season of Advent, this is a time for us to reaffirm our faith, to recognize our little faith and how little trust we really have. It's a time of confession. It's a time to reaffirm our commitment and our love for God's plan of salvation. Not just a time to buy presents and decorate the house. It's a time for us individually to reaffirm, yes, Lord, I believe in the one you sent, in the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe in the salvation you have won for me through Jesus' death and resurrection. So, an important point is that God accomplishes his will, which often seems impossible. Mary said that, I think, or the angel said that to Mary. Mary's next week. So the reality is, whether you believe it or not, God's will is accomplished, okay? So let's close this out. Turn to verse 57. Everybody with me? The birth of Johnny. When it was time for Elizabeth to have her baby, she gave birth to a son. Her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown her great mercy, and they shared her joy. On the 8th day, they came to circumcise the boy. They were going to name him after his father, but his mother spoke up and said, "No, he's to be called John." They said to her, "There's no one among your family that has that name." So they made signs to his father to find out what he would like to name the boy. He asked for a writing tablet, and to everyone's amazement, he wrote, "His name is John." Immediately, his mouth was opened, his tongue was loosed, he began to speak, praising God. The neighbors were all filled with awe throughout the hill country of Judea. People were talking about these things. Everyone who heard this wondered, what then is this child going to be? For the Lord's hand was with him. Don't turn the page yet. So the first thing is the great drama over the name. Now, what happened between the temple and now the birth between Elizabeth and Zechariah? He told her the name of the child because she knew it. Interestingly, they don't believe her. So Zechariah has to write down the name John. Okay, that's the first thing, the amount of uproar there was over the name. But secondly, once Zechariah's mouth is opened, we see what? A changed man. He's still old, but now he's an old, changed man. And you know, therein we learn something. Sometimes God just has to what? Forgive me for this. He has to shut us up so that we can listen and learn. Don't you think it's appropriate that Zechariah couldn't speak? Have you ever been in a time where you couldn't speak, John? Anybody ever been in a time they couldn't talk? I had surgery on my polyps about 15 years ago and I couldn't talk. My wife was elated. But you know, think about that. What went through the mind and life of that old man during those 10 months? He had to think, listen, and ponder. And he is a changed man. He went through, I'm sure, a time of confession. Lord, what an idiot I was. And now when his mouth is opened, all he does is praise God. And he is filled with the Spirit. So sometimes, folks, when God's trying to get through to you and me, I don't want you to be silent for 9 months, but maybe we have to just be quiet and listen, ponder, and learn what God is trying to teach us. Now turn the page, and you may read Zechariah's song known as the Benedictus. Let's go. Verse 67. His father Zechariah, filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies, hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our fathers, to remember his holy covenant, the oath swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies, and to enable us to serve him without fear, in holiness, righteousness, before him all our days. And you, child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins. Because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven, to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace. And the child grew and became strong in spirit.
And he lived in the desert until he appeared publicly to Israel.
So, verse 78, what is the rising sun? The Lord Jesus Christ. That's a messianic symbol from Malachi. So may we learn to live, trust, and praise God. In Jesus' name, amen.